New York City. They say if you can make it here, you can make it anywhere. That's exactly what Walt Disney thought over 40 years ago. The New York World's Fair of 1964 was the last of the great fairs and left behind a legacy for New Yorkers. An expansive public park known as Flushing Meadows was used in both the 1939 and 1964 fairs, and today is a grand park. To tell us a little bit more, here's the founder of the Extinct Attractions Club, Mr. David O'Neill.
Thanks, Brian. Hi, everybody. I'm out here in Flushing Meadows today in front of the awesome Unisphere, which was the symbol of the 1964 World's Fair here in New York.
Unisphere, the largest representation of our globe ever attempted. Unisphere, the largest stainless steel structure yet built. Stainless steel. Why? Because it is to become a permanent landmark, Unisphere must be virtually maintenance-free, yet remain enduringly beautiful.
You know, folks, the first time I saw the Carousel of Progress wasn't until 1995 in Florida. I was on a trip with my wife, Amber, and I was so excited that I was going to finally get a chance to see the Carousel of Progress. I had seen Viewmasters, and I'd heard the song Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow played on the Space Mountain Concourse over in Anaheim. Didn't know the words, though, but just thought it was such a cool song. When the monitors in line, when we were standing there waiting to go in, they were having Richard Sherman and Robert Sherman were singing Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow on the piano to Walt, and I was like, this is so cool.
So there's a great big beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great big beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.
We ran down, sat in the front row, and were just blown away. And since then, I wanted to learn so much more about it. And the 1964 World's Fair, to me, seemed like such a mysterious thing that I really tried to research it. And I found out a lot about it, especially about where all the attractions came from for Disneyland, from the fair. But lucky enough for you guys, you don't have to hear me talk about it today, because I have brought together some of the biggest Disney legends on this DVD for you, and they're going to tell you the story of the Carousel of Progress. Okay, let's take it away, Brian.
The Carousel of Progress story begins in the 1950s. Wait a second, Dave?
What's up? What's wrong?
Hey, listen, I've got another gig today. Do you think that maybe we could pick this up later?
Sorry, ladies and gentlemen, there seems to be a few technical difficulties here with our friend Brian. We're gonna get it sorted out. Just hang on just a second here, okay? Brian?
Hey, wait, I've got an idea. Hang on a second. Let me make a phone call. Oh, great, Rex. Yes, the audience is right here now. Yes. Okay, great. Paul, could you switch the mic input to 2 for a new narration track? Ladies and gentlemen, the Extinct Attraction Club is pleased to present the son of the narrator of the original Carousel of Progress and our announcer for the Carousel of Progress story, Mr. Rex Allen Jr.
What? You got Rex Allen Jr., the son of the narrator? He sounds just like him. Well, awesome. Folks, get ready, because here comes Rex Allen Jr. telling you the story of the Carousel of Progress. Take it away, Rex.
The story of the Carousel of Progress starts back in early 1958. Walt Disney Productions was enjoying tremendous success with Walt's little park, Disneyland. The park was in the middle of an enormous expansion out in Tomorrowland with the addition of the monorail, submarine voyage, and motorboat cruise attractions in full construction mode. Despite this grand expansion, plans were being drawn up by Herb Ryman and Sam McKim for an expansion of Disneyland's Main Street area. Knowing full well that corporate sponsorship was a quick and very lucrative way to raise the needed capital for new areas and attractions for his park, Walt went after one of the biggest corporations in America, General Electric. Liberty Street and Edison Square would complement Main Street USA's architecture. Utilizing New York brownstones, San Francisco-style buildings, and the brick architecture of Chicago, Liberty Street and Edison Square seemed a natural fit for Disneyland. Edison Square was made to have particular interest to General Electric, as it would feature not only a regal statue of Thomas Edison, but also an all-new attraction featuring a look at the past, present, and future of living with the magic of electricity. This new attraction would contain over 40,000 square feet of lobby, theaters, and of course, fabulous General Electric products on display. These stationary theaters were designed to have incredible guest flow. Each show would be synchronized with the next theater, so that guests would move easily through the history and present and future of General Electric. The idea was that the audience would progress through progress. But Mr. Disney took a trip to Europe and discovered little mechanical birds. Walt asked Imagineers to try to do something similar for his all-new Tiki Room show. Disney legend Rolly Crump explains.
He got Blaine Gibson to start sculpting real-looking birds, and then pretty soon he said, you know, we ought to have some work sessions on what these birds do. And so then pretty soon they brought in George Bruns to start doing music and concepts of what the songs might be. And so little by little, it just was brought together by a lot of synergism.
We can have lots of birds, and he said some of them will flip their wings and tails, and some of them will turn their heads and tweet. And he said some of them will do all sorts of different things. They won't all do the same, but they'll all breathe.
Just as we had to learn to make our animated cartoons talk, we had to find a way to make these characters talk too. Now, to accomplish this, we created a new type of animation. So new that we had to invent a new name for it.
Audio animatronics?
Right, audio animatronics.
Ooh.
Audio for sound.
See, and electronically animated by sound. That's what he's trying to say.
Thank you, that's all he's trying to say.
Excuse me, Walt.
It's okay.
Jose, wake up. It's showtime.
Oh, buenos dias, senorita. My siestas are getting shorter and shorter.
With the success in the Tiki Room, it was clear that audio animatronics were the new thing. And of course, General Electric wanted to be part of the latest Disney progress.
Aloha. It is showtime now in Walt Disney's enchanted Tiki Room. Hurry, hurry to Tiki Room. Tiki's make drum go boom. Magic is happening. All the birds and flowers sing. Better come see this thing. Walt Disney's enchanted Tiki Room. Come to the Tiki Room. Hurry to the Tiki Room.
Now, Walt knew that GE was planning to have a large pavilion at the upcoming World's Fair in New York. So he shelved the Edison Square concept and put all effort into a show-stopping pavilion at the fair, now known as Progress Land.
Of the four attractions for the 1964-65 World's Fair, one of them was going to be sponsored by General Electric. And they were highly desirous of showing what a better life through electricity can be. And so it became kind of a commercial theme in that there would be some kind of animated show that would show how your life would be so wonderful if you bought General Electric appliances for your house.
The Carousel of Progress was a show for General Electric, as you know, to design to show the evolution of electricity's use in the home until the present day. And of course, the topper was supposed to be the present day.
Our television console is more than just a TV set. It has a built-in video tape recorder.
Now we can record our favorite shows for viewing at a more convenient hour.
All of the people were the first AA people, and Mama and all of those, and then the cat and the dog. We'd never done cats or dogs, you know, we hadn't done anything.
He was using it to show that he could create new attractions that would work at Disneyland and in the new park in Florida. And at that time, we started transitioning into where does he go east, and it turned out to be Central Florida. And how correct that location was and that movement was is demonstrated by the unbelievable result of it.
When Bob and I were at the studio, we were always inundated with work. We had so many things going on. And you'd hear things about Walt's doing stuff for the World's Fair, and it's, oh, great, that's nice. I mean, we didn't have any opinion. because it wasn't something we were involved with. We sort of like stepped backwards into a couple of the major events that took place at the World's Fair, but that was because we were like troubleshooters at the studio.
Outside of the opening of Disneyland, the creation of theme parks, probably the most important event in the history of Disney theme parks was the 1964 World's Fair in New York. This allowed the Disney Company financially to create, expand, nurture the Imagineering department. Before, it was this group of little oddballs working in a shack, so to speak. But with the money that poured in from sponsors, Walt was able to invest real time, manpower, money into researching and developing and creating incredible technology expressly for theme parks. It wasn't a case of taking someone else's monorail and, you know, refixing it for a theme park environment. This was technology that was created expressly for theme park attractions.
Progress Land's distinctive dome was an icon at the fair designed by Welton Beckett and Associates. This dramatic architecture made a perfect location for the carousel show.
Welton Beckett and Associates conceived this vast domed carousel theater for General Electric. The roof is a lamella dome formed by two layers of steel pipes creating a spiral web. The pipes are anchored at the circumference on a ring girder set atop sloping pipe columns. Experience with this lamella dome portends substantial reduction in the cost of pipe frame structure this type. Under it, General Electric is showing the ways our lives have been changed by electricity.
The pavilion you will see next April is the result of the combined talents and creative ideas of many people. You have a wonderful building designed by Welton Beckett and Associates.
You're always trying to do something a little different, a little bit more exaggerated than you would normally do. And so you always, and you don't really have to have the architecture last very long anyway. So you can do some things that are more futuristic. And it was a good building. I mean, people had a lot of fun there.
The entire Disney team has been called on to develop entertaining and exciting attractions. The design talents of Wet Enterprises, all the special skills of our key personnel here at the Walt Disney Studio, and 8 years of experience in creating attractions and being a good host to nearly 40 million people at Disneyland. And your New York World's Fair staff has worked closely with us to assure that the overall theme and each individual area of the pavilion will accomplish General Electric's goals at the fair. We think you will be happy with the results. But more important, we think your guests will be excited about the entertainment, the exhibits, and especially about the General Electric Company. Why? Because what we're attempting to do is to create unique attractions for every part of your pavilion at the fair.
The creations that came out of the New York World's Fair, the People Mover, audio animatronics, it's countless, the number of innovations to accommodate large number of people and entertain them in the same way that are directly responsible to the work at the World's Fair.
The Carousel Theater actually got its start as a dinosaur attraction for General Motors.
Oddly enough, we just happened to have such a theater concept that was left over from 1958. Claude Coates and I were working on a theater with a rotating carousel theater for a General Motors dinosaur exhibit in 1958.
Some kind of a thing that would relate a little bit to what we did in Fantasia. And in Fantasia, we had a Tyrannosaurus Rex actually fighting a Stegosaurus, which they were not contemporaries.
That's an example of the kind of development we would do, and then it doesn't go anywhere, but we never throw it away. There's always drawings and models left over. So the minute the GE show started, somebody said, oh, well, let's drag out the old Claude Coates carousel. because it's a theater of seats that rotates around a stationary set of stages, which would be very practical, very easy to do. So that set the stage, if you will, for the overall configuration of a building that was actually going to be a giant donut that was like a railroad car. In fact, it used steel rails and steel wheels right off railroad equipment.
In keeping with the round design of the attraction, Progressland would include a rare feature never before used in the design of an attraction. And this large, round, incredible, space-age structure, the audience actually rides around the show like a carousel.
The Carousel Theater is circular in form and is divided into six equal segments. This is the loading stage area. As the audience take their seats, the 60-foot-wide kaleidophonic screen is activated electronically, and with thousands of good old GE bulbs pulsating to the overture, you actually see music as you hear it. Then the audience moves to stage one.
A rotating model was created by Harriet Burns to show the public and General Electric this revolutionary concept.
And I thought it was such a shame to destroy that. I'd give anything if they had not destroyed it, because on all of the little props, the little stove and the little birdcage, I had even the miniature print, you know, of a little newspaper in the bottom of the birdcage, everything, gad, and even the little toothbrushes. But it really helped sell it to the sponsors, because when GE came, they said, well, if it's any, they said, we've never seen a model this beautifully done, museum model, anything, this perfectly done. They said, if you do the real thing as perfectly as this, well, it'll be a sensation. And it was.
The entire Progressland show was Walt's idea 100%. He loved the idea of showcasing the progress the American family has made and will continue to make in the 20th century. General Electric loved the idea, as the World's Fair would generate even more traffic than Disneyland.
My first experience at the Carousel of Progress, and I was just, basically, I was taken by storm. I was just so impressed at the time of the technology, which I think moved me the most, of how things were put together. Back in 1964, this particular show was so far ahead of its time. Moving walkways, moving ramps, the whole building actually turning was just totally unheard of for that kind of technology back then. It was, again, ahead of its time.
The Carousel Show marked the first grand use of human audio animatronics.
You can have a robotic animated figure. It won't do anything unless you tell every specific part what to do and when to do it and in exact motions.
This is the stage for Act 1 of the Carousel Theater Progress. Stages for the other acts are being assembled at other places in the studio for a complete audio animatronic dress rehearsal. Now, this contraption here might look like something from outer space.
This contraption was shown on television as a device used to program the figures. However, Bob Gurr tells us that what you see may not be what you get.
So everybody immediately had new ideas as to how you're going to program things. And since these were humans rather than animals, somebody said, oh, well, we just simply replicate the motion of a human being. And another guy says, oh, that's easy. We'll build a harness and we'll strap it on somebody, and then we'll connect little electrical parts called potentiometers. We'll connect that to every one of the parts. And that way somebody can then act out the action that they want, and then we'll record it all in one motion. Well, that was a great idea, but that was also the second great idea that didn't work.
It's actually a control harness for programming the actions and gestures of our audio animatronic figures. Shall we show them how it works?
Very well.
This is the Carousel Theater host. Whatever the man in the harness does, this figure will respond simultaneously in the same manner. Did you care for your life? I don't think we better. No smoking on the stage.
It took forever to get that harness to do what you wanted to do, and of course, not everybody is a good actor. So it turns out Wathel Rogers was very good at understanding human motion, but it became pretty futile after a while when everybody could see that Wathel's having a terrible time with this animation suit.
The operator of the control harness has to be a bit of a ham actor, as you can see. You know, all of the operator's actions are recorded on tape, and separate tapes are made for each of our figures. And it takes lots of rehearsal and refinement to get the gestures to be lifelike.
And then somebody else comes along and says, well, you know, every joint has a potentiometer to control it, and every valve is going to be operated by its counterpart to the, you know, a servo valve control. Why don't we just move that control one at a time, and then, like building music, we'll simply build all the notes and pile them all up, and they'll all be on a tape, and then we'll have a full functioning figure. Well, that would take a long time to do, but it turned out somebody said, oh, well, we'll just make a flat console, we'll paint it up so it looks like a human, we'll simply put all these little control knobs on all the joints, and it'll be real easy to program because we'll concentrate on one motion at a time, and we'll build it all up layer by layer.
This electronically controlled method of programming can give us a wide range of movements. A broad gesture, two, the wink of an eye. That's it. Thank you.
Well, this thing was so logical, nobody thought of it, but very quickly that turned out to be the fastest thing of all, because now a programmer like Mark Davis or Wathel Rogers could sit and teach themselves how to turn a knob. And that turned out to be very, very fast. That was quite a revealing discovery, that instead of trying to mimic human motion with a harness, you could, in your brain, convert the motion that you wanted in a body that you were watching and let it run out your fingers on a knob.
These human animatronic marvels were sculpted by none other than Disney legend Blaine Gibson.
When we first did that show, I designed, I think, all of the heads. Well, all of the figures had to be sculpted, so I guess I'd sculpt a small one. But what I was able to do, and this was a very good fortune, there were people there who were glad to have their kids volunteer for that job, including Dick Irvine. One of his youngest daughters volunteered to do the young daughter.
The figures looked very lifelike, and with limited movement and the right environment, they looked very believable indeed.
Those were the bodies that we used. But for the heads, one or two of them I just used as a combination of teenagers that I knew. The one that, see, there's one, was one scene where a teenage boy and a teenage girl, or, and I think Mark has a kiss or something, Mark has the girl lifting her leg, you know, like, you know, it popped out.
And then the 16-year-old girl that was necking with her boyfriend, they had that. And that was also my arms, but they did polished nails on that and so forth. So they just, you know, we had to use people however we could use them.
It's quite a... an interesting process that we did all of those, but we did get the cooperation of people who had their children there, and I would borrow them and use them, not overstress them or anything, but just enough to get photos in most cases.
In fact, Walt liked the grandmother figure so well that he took her first class on the airplane to New York with him, all dressed up in her Sunday best.
The grandmother, we just cut her nails and didn't polish them for the old lady that sat in the wheelchair, you know, that we took to New York. And I got her a little Goodwill hat with cherries on it and the typical little grandma stuff.
The grandmother figure would later appear in Disney's Haunted Mansion 5 years later.
And in fact, all the women had my arms. They cast my arms. I was still at the studio. And even just shaving your arms, you have no idea that these little hairs make a difference. I missed it till it grew back in. And they cast them for, well, they made umpty nine. I've got some of them down in the basement, whole bucket full of those crazy arms. My daughter used to use them for Halloween.
But sculpted figures were only the first step. Now the Imagineers had to make the move. Disney legend Bob Gurr's accomplishments for Disneyland include the monorail, flying saucers, and Autopia, to name just a few. Bob was one of nearly a dozen Imagineers involved in this new process of audio animatronics.
And we were just starting to, you know, begin to see how to develop animated figures, because we didn't have a lot of figures as such, other than the Indians out in the Indian village and a few very rudimentary humans. Actually, the Ford Motor Company ride got started before the General Electric, and that had animated cavemen. And the machine shop at the studio was building these cavemen sort of like one at a time with no overall plan. And they were very heavy and very crude and very simple. And they didn't have to do much. And of course, they were cavemen, so if they were a little crude, well, it's fine. It fits the show. So I was asked to take a look at animation as sort of a wholesale thing. In other words, could we look at the whole thing as a uniform way of doing stuff? I had a team of draftsmen over in Glendale, and the machine shop was in Burbank. So every day we sent drawings over there, and the guys were making all these parts. And with the technicians at their workbenches, these guys would take sort of this basic modus operandi of basic parts and could make almost any kind of figure out of it.
Once the fellows at Imagineering got the figures moving, it was time to bring in the music men.
So we went down there, and they showed us a mock-up of what was going to be the Carousel of Progress, the GE Carousel of Progress. And they started explaining technically that they needed a number. It was like fitting a, creating a shoe, a foot to fit into a shoe. The shoe was already there. Now you have to create a foot that fits comfortably into the shoe. A song that could be so malleable that it could be played as a ragtime piece, and then a few as the carousel moved along, you'd play it the same piece as a jazz number, and then you'd play it as a swing number in the 40s, and then you'd play it in an up-to-date kind of version the way it would be in the 60s, the middle 60s. And so we were given all these needs, and also it has to be 40 something seconds long, no more, because it has. Then when the thing stops, then we go into the next chapter, and then it's sung again, and it's all these needed things, and then on top of everything else, Walt said, and it's all about the future. And he's describing this thing, and he said, see how electricity has changed. General Electric is the sponsor, and how electricity has come into our lives and made our lives better. And every day, new things are happening, and so we have to think about what's wonderful today is going to be even better tomorrow. So wonderful things are happening tomorrow. Walt was, at the best word to describe it, he was a futurist. He believed in the future, and he was a great salesman. He sold us on the whole concept, and we got all charged up, and we said, okay, well, we'll think of something, 45 seconds, and okay, and it has to be malleable, so it has to be changed into this kind of style or that kind. And all these little things were going around, swimming around in our brains. And we said, yeah, when Walt has a dream, everybody has to fall in line with it. So we started right with the middle of the song. We said, Walt has a dream, and that's the start. We follow his dream with mind and heart. He said, well, that's going to be a little bit, no, we'll never do that. Man has a dream.
Man has a dream, and that's the start. He follows his dream with mind and heart.
Now, what are we following? We're following the futurist, tomorrow. Well, what? He's always thinking about how big and gorgeous and beautiful tomorrow's going to be. Aha! There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, and tomorrow's just a dream away. Man has a dream, and that's the start. He follows his dream with mind and heart. And when it becomes a reality, it's a dream come true for you and me.
So there's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.
And that's how we wrote the song. It was Walt. We wrote a song about Walt, and it became the theme song of the Carousel of Progress.
The Sherman Brothers have written many of the wonderful songs for motion pictures and television shows, and I think this song, written especially for you, captures the spirit of the General Electric Pavilion at the New York World's Fair.
Thanks, boys.
Thanks,
say goodbye to the folks.
Bye-bye.
There's a great big beautiful tomorrow.
As I said, that's the spirit. Well, a beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away. That says we're going places. There's progress ahead. And that's just the mood we want for the whole pavilion.
In 1964, you had the Cuban Missile Crisis, what, a year or so earlier. I think the fear of the atomic bomb, there wasn't much of a future. Everybody was, it was a bleak, bleak future in everybody's minds and everybody's hearts at the time, because of that time, the atomic bomb was a major scare for children like us and 11 years old. I think because of the music and before It's a Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow, there was something to look forward to.
There's a great big beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great big beautiful tomorrow, and tomorrow just a dream away. Man has a dream, and that's the start. He follows his dream with mind and heart.
And when it becomes a reality,
it's a dream come true for you and me.
So there's a great big beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great big beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.
This particular song was simple, but an effective ballad about the man they so admired, Walt Disney. After much preparation by WED, Walt Disney presented a progress report film to General Electric executives. Debuting the plans for Progress Land, including the Carousel of Progress show and the Amazing Sky Dome Spectacular, a show on the roof of the Carousel Dome itself.
Here, for example, is a scale model of the General Electric Carousel Theater, a theater in which the audience itself moves in their seats around the stages. The actors, well, they're not real people, but they are a talented and interesting cast. We call them audio animatronic figures, and they talk and act like human beings. The Carousel Theater will present a warm and entertaining portrayal of how life has changed through electrical energy. The same kind of exciting and unique entertainment is what we're planning for every area of the General Electric Pavilion. So, see you at the fair, and remember,
there's a great big beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great big beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.
Longtime Disney Imagineer Marty Sklar wrote a script for the show that was able to make an emotional connection to the family in the Carousel show. The family presented never aged, and the audience was never quite sure if it was the same family in all four acts or four generations. Here, in this rare test recording, we get some insight into a few of the concepts for the family.
Television is recessed in the wall with a picture area. Well, it's almost as big as motion picture screens were a few years ago. Let's turn it on by remote control and see what's on.
Friends, does nasal drip, drip, drip keep you awake like a leaky faucet? Well, thanks to Prognostic Progress.
This remote TV control is a lot faster on the draw than a man's arm reaching for the dial.
The Carousel Show was hosted by a father, much like the character of Wilbur Watt from the Edison Square concept. The father sat in his rocking chair and was a friendly kind of man, voiced by Disney legend and my father, Rex Allen.
And believe me, things couldn't be better than they are today. Yes, sir, we take a lot of pride in our home. Got all the latest things like lightning rods on the house, telephone, gas lamps, and the newest design in cast iron stoves.
They were started working on Carousel Progress in about 1962 to 63. And heck, I was 12, 13 years old at that time. And trying to be a singer, I was playing guitar and working in a little folk groups and cowboy groups and that sort of stuff and trying to learn my craft. And my dad walked in about the time he was doing this, and
And he said, I'm doing some very unusual things. And I said, what are you doing, Dad? And he says, well, he says, you know about all the narrations I'm doing for Disney? And I said, yes. He says, well, I'm also doing something that I'm not really sure what it is. He says, it's something to do with robots. And, you know, robot was a new word back then, you know. I think it wasn't it Isaac Asimov that invented the word robot? Well, you know, I'd seen some of those sci-fi magazines when I was a kid, so I didn't know whether it was going to be, you know, this guy with a big round head or, you know, what the heck was going on here.
Well, Walt said, we'll have a human. He said, we'll do it just like a skull, and we'll do it just like they were created, with every ligament, every muscle, every tendon, everything that a person has, we should have on the audio animatronic figure. So when they had gotten it worked out, every rubber band and everything in there that could speak or to, and Walt would, you know, crook his eyebrows, and he always did this faces, you know, he made. And he said, when they do all of those things, well, then we'll know we have enough, even though we don't use 360 different movements. He said, we'll know we have enough that we can use them if we need them. So it was really remarkable to see that work out. And then we transferred that to we were still at the studio when we did all of that. Then when we moved over to Glendale to Imagineering, that was when we did the Carousel of Progress.
Rex Allen, a film star and narrator of hundreds of Disney films such as The Incredible Journey, numerous true life adventure films, and of course, scores of television shows, was a natural choice to play the father. In fact, I think he did a great job, and I should know. He played the part of my dad every day.
When it comes to Carousel Progress, Dad didn't tell me what he was doing. Dad said, well, it's, I don't know, it's something to do with the future, and they're going to talk about this and that. And he was very evasive about it. He didn't talk much about it. And to be, I'm not really sure whether he, well, I'm sure he did go through and see and watch them, what they were building and so on and so forth. But, you know, Dad would do the narration first, and then they sync the character to his, what he was doing in his delivery.
All of the appliances are improved today. Take a refrigerator. Why, I remember when
the man of the house had to work twice as many hours to earn one as he does now.
So Blaine and I went to Western Costume, and we picked just black and white costumes, just something temporary, to put on just what you call store mannequins, just as a setup to show the size and the sort of the space, how we would fill it in, how it would look.
Walt chose the key man as an actor. He was a man that was fairly popular on TV and stuff at that time. And he came over, first we took photographs of him, but then I went up and had his head cast by Bob Schiffer, who was the chief makeup man at Disney at that time. And Bob Schiffer was very good at what he did. And so we made this cast without, you know, the eyes naturally are not in there. But I did have the mouth and some of the other things. And I would have done it a little differently now because I know more now than I did then. But I would have left a little separation between the two lips, which would have been made it much easier for the machine to make the two work together. And and then I had him come over after I'd sculpted up a head. I had him come over and pose for me, which he was very happy to do. And Preston Hansen was his name. That came out okay. And that is one of the reasons we had a big screen over where we worked, was because of the, we had some girls that I said, well, you certainly don't have to wear you don't have to be in the nude if you don't want to. I said, we're utilizing this as a model for the sculptors to do. But this particular professional model that we relied on more than any other, said, well, no, she did work at night and people didn't like creases from the bikinis or the other kinds of things that they would have used. So I said, well, fine, you do as you like. And so she chose to be in the nude. I mean, that's how that happened. It wasn't that we were requiring her to be in the nude. And now the guys, naturally, they could wear a little more.
Welcome to the General Electric Carousel of Progress. Now, most carousels just go round and round without getting anywhere. But on this one, at every turn, we'll be making progress. And progress is not just moving ahead. It's dreaming and working and building a better way of life. These immortal words set the tone for the show, and thus started the carousel show running. Much like the Edison Square concept, the show begins in the gay 90s. Father introduces the family, mother, son, daughter, and the family dog, and of course, Uncle Orville. From here, the world just before electricity was being discussed. Figures would appear and reappear from behind a scrim and demonstrate the new marvels being unveiled by a progressive company called General Electric. Then, before you know it, Father starts to sing the theme song, and we are whisked away to the next scene. Now we enter the 1920s, and the living room is simply filled with all new electronic doodahs and gizmos. Wires are strewn about, and Father begins to tell us about the hottest summer on record. Meanwhile, Junior appears and plays jazz on the record player. And Cousin Orville is heard complaining about privacy as Father explains Orville's invention called air cooling. The voice of Orville was the one and only Mel Blanc, and this was the only voice he ever did for Disney. Noting the need for air conditioning, the carousel starts back up again, and we are headed straight for the fabulous 40s. Father explains that the do-it-yourself craze is what we are all into now, as well as a new concept known as the rat race. Mother appears offstage and is trying to paint what is called a rumpus room and is using a cake mixer to stir her paint. Television is now affordable, and Father tells us that no matter what GE does, there still will be bad guys shooting good guys and vice versa. He goes on to explain how one day people will learn Greek and Latin over the airwaves, only to find Grandma watching boxing. Father begins to sing the theme song, and we are on our way to present day. In this final scene, we arrive in General Electric's Medallion home. It's now Christmas time, and the entire family is gathered around the tree. This is the grand finale, and GE is able to showcase all the new appliances and display them to eager customers watching the show. Mother explains how she has more time during the holidays thanks to her dishwasher and self-cleaning oven. They display colored translucent walls that change color to affect mood, thanks to GE. Mother does most of the talking, and Father occasionally gets a word in and says, "Progress is something we can't take for granted. Progress takes a lot of people wanting it and willing to work for it." And so next, Mother and I invite you to come along and see some of the electrifying new ideas from General Electric for our city and for your own hometown. Thus ending the four-act show with the theme song once again. As the show came to a close, Father once again is heard over the speaker in the exit area and says, "And now a new springtime of progress awaits you. Spring up out of your seats and head for the doorway to the future. Please keep moving and don't stand in the way of progress." Fair visitors were whisked up a speed ramp to the next part of the show. Next was the Sky Dome Spectacular, a show in which we learn how GE was harnessing the sun's power and watched a thermal fusion experiment.
Our artists are painting some of the many effects which will be projected into the full-size dome. clouds, twilight skies will appear, and shooting stars will flash across the sky. The Sky Dome Spectacular dramatizes man's efforts to harness the energy produced by the sun. From this viewing terrace here, the audience will experience a dramatic electrical storm, a solar explosion, and see the sun as a hot ball of fire. As the scientist narrator tells how atomic power plants will generate vast quantities of electrical energy, the scenes the artists are painting will show a fertile, blooming desert and a city of the future. At the finish of the Sky Dome Spectacular, the people will be directed down this ramp to the center well of the pavilion. There, they will witness an actual nuclear fusion demonstration by the use of actual equipment. Following this, the visitors will continue to the first level for the fun and excitement of GE's all-electric Medallion City.
The General Electric Pavilion was an amazing smash hit during its run from 1964 to 1965. An average of over 41,000 guests experienced the show each day. 99% of these guests rated the GE show as the best part of the fair. The Carousel Theater was truly amazing. Six 20-horsepower DC General Electric motors moved the enormous theater and over 45,000 people per day. Never in the history of theater has a show ever been so efficient in the manner in which it controlled the audience flow, and it's one of the reasons for its great success.
Disney got an extra bonus when it helped create attractions for the World's Fair, because it also got to keep those attractions when the fair was over. And it was a jackpot of great attractions that filtered into Disneyland throughout the late 60s. One by one, Mr. Lincoln would move into the Opera House. Pepsi Cola's Small World would extend the boundary of Fantasyland. Ford's Magic Skyway gave us not only the diorama that the railroad now goes through at Disneyland, but also it gave us the ride system that would be turned into the People Mover. There was also General Electric's Carousel of Progress, which was one of the most exciting, heavily visited attractions at the whole World's Fair.
Walt used this information in a proposal to GE, originally entitled Progress Land at Disneyland. Walt wanted to bring the carousel show and, of course, General Electric sponsorship to Disneyland as part of the all-new Tomorrowland planned to open in 1967. This all-new Tomorrowland would feature some very big corporate names like Goodyear, Coke, McDonnell Douglas, and Monsanto. On June 2, 1967, this all-new World on the Move opened.
When it was moved to Disneyland, you had the first floor was the show, and then you went up to a Progress City model on the second floor.
The Carousel of Progress at Disneyland sported an enormous large building with a telescopic General Electric logo out in front. Inside the show remained almost the same as the World's Fair version. Rex Allen was back as the father, and things stayed the same except in the very last act of the show. In the final act, all references to the Medallion home were cut, as well as dated products like the kitchen lighting, and new things like recording TV shows for later viewing were added to showcase the way GE would make progress now and in the future.
Our television console is more than just a TV set. It has a built-in video tape recorder.
Now we can record our favorite shows for viewing at a more convenient hour.
My favorite part of the whole ride was the last scene at Christmas time with the lady, the 60s lady with her bouffant hairdo. And you could see, as they're talking, you could see Progress City out the window behind them. And what was really neat is they would be talking about Grandma and Grandpa at the airport, and you'd see a light almost look like an airplane landing or taking off or something. As I was saying, it was really neat afterwards to be able to go up and actually look at Progress City up close. That was really neat, and I think it's unfortunate that today there is not that opportunity at Walt Disney World. I hope maybe someday that'll change. It just inspired me. I think one of the best parts of Disney of Disneyland that influenced me significantly as a child is just all the ways that they impacted my imagination.
In 1967, Dad said, come on, we're all going to go to Disneyland. And, you know, I was about 18 years old. And, you know, the only thing I cared about was playing guitar and you know, and dating and all of those things like that. That's all you care about. All you have is hormones and a guitar, you know.
I remember going, and like every other kid, and when you walked in the gates of Disneyland, I don't care whether you were 18 years old or 80 years old, you all of a sudden became an 8-year-old. You know, that didn't change any. Everybody was that way. I mean, we all put on the darn floppy-eared hats, you know, and walked around. But the thing I thought was really cool about it was that because of all of the things that Dad had done for Disney over the years, we had a private escort. We didn't have to wait in any lines. I mean, that was cool, you know. It's not that I felt that we were better than anybody else. I just was glad I didn't have to stand in all those lines. And he didn't tell us, kids. He says, come on, we're going to go over here to see this thing, this GE deal. I don't know what the heck it is. And so we go at the end of Tomorrowland, and, you know, all of us kids, we want to get on, we'll ride those space things. And I can remember as a kid, like every other kid, you know, you want to get tall enough that you can drive the cars, you know. And so he says, come on, we're going to go into this GE thing. So we went in, and I was, even at 18 years old, I mean, I was just wonderfully fascinated. But the truth is that I didn't realize it was Dad until I got about a third of the way into it. And then I looked over at him, and he was kind of smiling. I said, Dad, that's you, isn't it? He said, yeah. I said, well, it doesn't look like you up there. Why couldn't they make the guy look like you instead of, you know, some guy with a mustache? You know, there's a Dad, you don't have a mustache, you know? And he says, well, you know, that's just the way they wanted to do it. That's what Walt wanted to do. But it went through it and then went back through it again to really sit and watch it because, you know, it was, I think the thing that Dad, what made him so proud of Carousel of Progress was that he felt that it was innovative. He felt that the Carousel of Progress was something new. Yeah, I talked about future and all those things like that and where we've been and where we're going and all that sort of thing, but he felt that it was, that the experience itself was something that was different. You know, it wasn't just the standard thing. It was something that you could look back on and say, hey, you know, this is pretty cool.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
There's a great day.
I saw Carousel of Progress when it just opened at the park, and it was, I mean, of course, everybody sang that, you know, the song. We all knew Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow and sing it over, and I ran on that ride dozens of times, you know, it was fantastic. What was also fantastic is I had been privy to a lot of the early Epcot stuff that had been coming out. So I had all these press kits, which I still have, and photos and things of what Disney was proposing to do for Epcot. And then you go, not only do you see Carousel of Progress, but then you go upstairs and there's the Epcot Center. And I mean, it was fantastic.
In the World's Fair version, the backdrop at the end of the show was that of Christmas in modern times.
It even has a self-cleaning oven. And we were able to pick our appliance colors from so many beautiful combinations.
All of the appliances are improved today. Take a refrigerator. Why, I remember when...
When the man of the house had to work twice as many hours to earn one as he does now. And today we have a better product.
You took the words right out of my mouth, dear.
And I'm thrilled with my new dishwasher.
But now at Disneyland, the backdrop was that of a spectacular city. Known as Epcot, the experimental prototype community of tomorrow was waiting to be viewed by Disneyland guests by going up the speed ramp to the second floor of the carousel building. Guests then were able to view Walt's last great dream, Epcot.
I was at another birthday party of Walt's, and he asked me to go down in the basement to where we were going to see some films. And just the two of us, he says, I've got a secret I'm going to share with you, and I want your opinion about it. So we got down there, I said, what is it? He says, I'm thinking of building another Disneyland in Florida. What do you think of that? I said, well, Walt, you know, I had my doubts about the last one. Remember when we drove out there and it was none but orange groves? And I had my doubts about the last one when it was so far from Los Angeles, away from the main population. And I didn't really know what you were going to build anyway. But I was finally convinced it's good. But now that I've had the experience of living through all that, I'm an authority on this stuff, and I can tell you, don't build it in Florida. He says, don't build it? Why not? I said, well, Disneyland is a unique proposition. That means the only one of its kind in the world. People come here, they've got to go there. It's like the Grand Canyon or the Niagara Falls or the pyramids in Egypt. He says, yeah, but Art, he said, when we built the last one, we had just a few acres, and people crowded around us and built stuff that I didn't like to see that were surrounded. It'd be like drilling an oil well in a small field and you didn't own any ground around it. He says, I can get 10,000 acres or more down there in Florida, and I can have room to do things. Also, we have an idea for something I want to build more than anything else now that with Disneyland's a success. He says, I want this to be a place in the next Disneyland called Epcot.
Spelled E-P-C-O-T. Experimental Prototype Community of Tomorrow.
In other words, the first one was just a model, and now you're going to do what you really wanted to do. He said, I didn't know at that time I wanted to do, but now I do. And what do you think? I said, well, in that case, I take it all back. I would approve of it.
How do we start answering this great challenge? Well, we're convinced we must start with the public need. And the need is not just for curing the old ills of old cities. We think the need is for starting from scratch on virgin land and building a special kind of new community.
Progress City, named after Progress Land, featured monorails, people movers, and a fully functional downtown city with modern progressive approaches to planning a community. Over 6,900 square feet of space were used to showcase how we all live better electrically.
And in the Carousel of Progress, you can get a view of tomorrow, a model city of the future. It's based on a concept developed by Walt Disney for a community he called Epcot, Experimental Prototype City of Tomorrow. Realistic to the smallest detail, this animated model is a living blueprint of new ideas and systems for future cities. The concept for Epcot is one part of Walt Disney's master plan for the future Disney World in Florida. The city of tomorrow, possible today with the technology and imagination of American industry.
As the familiar theme song played in the background, Rex Allen once again was heard saying, "Looks like tomorrow is already here. We'll always come back to Progress City, and we hope you will too. Everything you see here in our all-electric city is really possible today." Progress City was a big part of the show, and even the Wedway People Mover crossed over it to give guests a better view of the future. GE even took out 2-page ads in national magazines to promote it.
And that was the start of Epcot, which never turned out to be that way after Walt died.
When Walt Disney died in late 66, the Florida project had gone to maybe not a point of no return, But, you know, so much land had been acquired and been purchased, it would have been hard to pull out. But that was the thought and the fear that without Walt, without the creative guiding force, the glue that held the company together, what would they do? It was like chickens with their heads cut off. And fortunately, Roy Disney stepped up and said, this is my brother's Walt's dream, and if nothing else, I'm going to get this open. His concern was primarily not Walt's concern. His concern was getting that theme park, the Magic Kingdom, open, because he knew that was where the money was, and that was always Roy's first thought. The city, we'll worry about that later, but it was the theme park that he was determined to get open.
Roy tried, I will say, dear Roy, he tried so hard, and he'd come over, you know, like I say, it wasn't just on the lot like it was at the studio. He'd have to come over and he'd walk around, and he didn't know what he was looking at, what we were doing. And so he'd always say, it's coming along, it's coming along, because he wanted to be encouraging, and yet he didn't understand, because some of our first steps of the projects looked pretty funny, you know, and he didn't know what we were doing. And he'd just say, it's coming along. But he'd try to encourage everybody. He was the sweetest man. He really was a dear.
The argument that was going on when Walt died about that Florida property was between Walt and Dad was, my dad said, look, we can't do that without some sort of a positive cash flow first. And I think we got to build a park and some hotels and something that will create a cash flow, and then we can think about the other. And Walt's going, no, 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 no. And I think maybe way in his back of his mind, he knew he didn't have time to do that, or he was beginning to suspect he didn't have time. And so that fight actually got settled simply because Walt died and the argument ended.
Well, a project like this is so vast in scope that no one company alone can make it a reality. But if we can bring together the technical know-how of American industry and the creative imagination of the Disney organization, I'm confident we can create right here in Disney World a showcase to the world of the American free enterprise system.
We were all very depressed after Walt died. And Roy Disney called a group of us together and to encourage us up in one of the little theaters that they had throughout the studio. And told us that if it was the last thing he did, he was going to see that this project got underway. And he got up there and told us that in very much emotion, in fact, he had tears in his eyes, he said, the last thing Walt did in St. Joseph's Hospital before he died was sketch what was then going to be Epcot on the ceiling. He'd sort of go over it with Roy, what was going to happen on the map that he had sort of simulating with his finger pointing to the ceiling. And it was a sad thing. He says, well, if it's the last thing I do, we're going to get that started.
Everybody was in shock. You know, everybody was, it was both that and we had an assignment. I mean, because Walt left us with 20 years worth of projects. You know, so we all knew we had to just go ahead with what was planned.
The old way it was, you know, kind of the 50s and 60s idea of what the future would be like. Because when I was a little kid, I thought that's what the future would be like. I thought the whole world would look like that, you know, just white concrete. And, you know, the only colors would be like aqua and aluminum and stuff like that. And you know, I was just, I couldn't wait till the future came and everything looked like that.
Now I'd like to conclude here and tell you that they lived happily ever after, but that's just not the case. In October of 1971, just 4 years after the show opened in Anaheim, Walt Disney World opened in Florida to the public. It quickly beat Disneyland in attendance, and it seemed everybody in the corporate world wanted a slice of this new pie Disney was serving up. GE had abandoned the campaign of progress is our most important product. GE wanted the public to buy now, not in the future. GE further thought that Florida, not California, was the place to take their message, and they signed a 10-year contract to sponsor the attraction in Florida.
General Electric had yanked their show from Disneyland because they said that 80% of the people that came to Disneyland were Californians, and they would see the same show over and over again so that they wouldn't get the advertising that they wanted.
I was very, very sad when Carousel Progress went away. And while I enjoyed America Sings, still to this day, my all-time favorite ride remains Carousel of Progress.
In fact, even the theme song of the show was taken away, and the Sherman Brothers were forced to write a new song entitled Now is the Time.
A new president came in, and he said, I don't want to talk about tomorrows, which was the song, Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. He wanted to talk about today. He wanted to talk about now. And he said, I want GE now. And all people to realize now is what it's all about. And it was a whole shift of gears for a lot of the people, including Bob and myself, because they requested, would we come back and write a brand new song? Not a revised song, but a brand new song for the Florida GE Carousel of Progress. And so it was not an easy job, actually, to come up with what we did. But we came up with a very positive statement about today. And it was quite different than the one we had done for the original. But I like it as well. It's a kind of a powerful song. It goes like, now is the time, now is the best time, now is the best time of your life. Life is a prize, reach out and win it. Open your eyes and see how you win it. That's a very bright, up-tempo thing, and they loved that one. They said, that's the one we're gonna use. So for about 25 years, they used, now is the time, now is the best time, now is the best time of your life.
Well, if it's time for anything, it's time to move on. And it's time to sing the song again. Come on, everybody. Now is the time, now is the best time, now is the best time of your life. Life is a progress.
And when they got down to Florida, the Klieg lights singed the hair, you know, that melted the plastic hair, the nylon hair. So they had to go back to real hair wigs.
It's hard to imagine how life could be any easier. Yes, sir, we got all the latest things.
You are watching the General Electric Show, Carousel of Progress at Walt Disney World.
Yes, sir, we've got everything to make life easier.
The lifelike figures in this GE show dramatize the many ways electricity has brought progress to America.
Here we are in the frantic 40s, and it's amazing how everything is improving. My favorite is the electric dishwasher.
The show takes us from the turn of the century right up to today.
Now is the best time. Now is the best time of your life.
It's a fun trip that reminds us how far we've come and the vital role electricity has played in our progress. Progress for People from General Electric.
Times change, people change, and that sort of stuff. Well, they stopped doing all of those, the nature things and that sort of stuff. Maybe because they've done enough of them, I don't know. But I think the audience changed. The audience grew up. There was more television around. There were people were more aware and so on and so forth. Well, Dad hadn't done anything for Disney in like 10 years. And Hanna-Barbera called and asked Dad to be the narrator on a little project they were working on called Charlotte's Web. And so Dad went and did Charlotte's Web for them, and it became a huge success. Well, he got a call from I believe it was Roy Disney, and said, and was just so upset with Dad about how could you do that to our family? Because Disney, you know, when you went to work for Disney, you became a part of, they felt like you were a family. You know, some people would consider it a commune. It was got so bad for some people, but Dad, you know, he said to, I believe it was Roy, he says, Roy, he says, I haven't done anything for you guys in 10 years. He says, you know, I got a family, I need to eat, you know, and they offered me a good deal here. And Roy said, well, don't you understand that you can't, you're a Disney, you're Disney. And Dad said, well, I may be Disney, but you aren't paying me anything either. So, did they have a falling out? Absolutely not. That's not what it was at all. It's Dad's career went on, just like Disney's career went on, you know.
The entire show remained the same, except some of the voices were changed to re-record the new theme song. Rex Allen no longer played the father. He was replaced by actor Andrew Duggan. And the last act of the show was changed dramatically.
It's time for me to start my New Year's Eve spectacular. Omelette superbe avec jambon.
Mmm, not the famous omelette superbe avec jambon.
Known in other circles as ham and eggs.
For example, in the second scene, the daughter responds to the dad's comment when he says,
it's a man's world out there, Jane.
Well, it won't always be, Father.
Now, cut that out, Queenie. You're supposed to be man's best friend.
Back at Disneyland, the Carousel Theater was gutted and replaced by an all-new Salute to America's Bicentennial, created by Disney legend Mark Davis.
So they had this empty building, and they wanted a show for it. So this was the first time that Mark did a show all the way through without Walt. Walt had seen the bears, but Mark had designed the stage and such for the bear jamboree. And finished it without Walt, but Walt was in the beginning of it. So this was the first show that was all Mark.
This audio animatronics attraction filled the tiny Carousel of Progress stage with a four-act musical Salute to America. Imagineer Jeff Burke explains the difficulty of cramming so many critters onto the small carousel stage.
There was a hand-select crew of us who were sent down to the field to shoehorn this in. Now, when I say shoehorn it into the Carousel of Progress, I mean that literally, because the Carousel of Progress, as you remember, was not designed for America Sings. America Sings took over for the General Electric Carousel of Progress. So a cast of 114 characters, sort of like would cover the entire stage at Radio City Music Hall, had to be concentrated within this tiny little theater. That's actually part of the charm of the show, that we fit so many characters into this small show space. It was a big headache, however, for those of us that were in charge of having to fit them all in.
Nobody had really done more or less the history of music from starting in the United States up to the present time. And he thought it would be fun to have all the different the jazz, the blues, and the rock and roll.
Okay, boys, that's the line and jive!
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, rocking all the time.
Easy.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, rocking all the time.
Disney continued to operate the show until 1992. At that time, no sponsor was found, and it was decided to restore the show to its 1964 level as a tribute to Walt Disney and the 30th birthday of the attraction. Now known as Walt Disney's Carousel of Progress, the show is a living tribute to Walt Disney and the Carousel Theater. Changes made to the new show include making a holiday a part of every act. For example, not only is Christmas celebrated, but other holidays are now included, like Valentine's Day, 4th of July, and Halloween. Rex Allen was once again called upon to be a part of this special version of the Carousel of Progress. Rex now played the grandpa, and Gene Shepherd of A Christmas Story fame now plays the father in this new show.
Oh no, you're not going to tell us about the old days when you didn't even have a car phone.
Hey, Trish, for a while we didn't even have a house phone, not to mention laser discs and high-def TV. Everything is automated today, including that.
Dad and the Disney organization got back closer together, and during that time period is probably the reason why when they redid Carousel of Progress, it didn't use Dad, or Dad didn't do it, if you want to know the honest truth, and that probably had a lot to do with Hanna-Barbera.
What should have been an extinct attraction was saved by the caring of Imagineers and is now a living tribute to the people who worked so hard to make Walt's dream come alive. Today, the area behind Main Street where Edison Square and Liberty Street were to be built is still an empty space. Edison Square and Liberty Street were never built, but Liberty Square did appear in Florida. The Disneyland Carousel Theater is now home to Innovations. But progress is still present, as guests aboard the Tomorrowland Transportation Authority, formerly known as the People Mover, can still view the model of Progress City today in Florida.
Presents Walt Disney's 20th century vision for the future. This model city dares to dream of the perfect community in which to work and live.
Now, most carousels just go round and round without getting anywhere. But our carousel went from New York to California and then down to Florida.
It was a great project, it really was, in its day to start the AA People.
Actually, as earlier we talked about working on a communal project, one after another with this man, where the final was much better than any one of us could have done by ourselves.
We suddenly got into a golden era with the GE Carousel of Progress for the World's Fair that everybody contributed sort of all at once, and the whole technology moved in a matter of just a couple of months.
It just was uncanny how these things, they didn't fall together. It wasn't just chaos. I mean, everything was organized from the very beginning. And it's uncanny how well these shows all came out, in my opinion.
We just zoomed way ahead of where we were earlier before we started. And in hindsight, I think we made more improvement, more change, more technological jump in that narrow period of time. We didn't really think about it. We finished it, and if Walt liked it, great. And that was the end. And we went on to something else. And it was always a new and exciting thing to do. We were working on Jungle Book, or we were working on Winnie the Pooh, or we were working on some other thing. And we were very much engrossed in that. And so if somebody said to us, hey, they really dug it at GE, they really loved the thing, we'd say, oh yeah, great. And that was about it. We never thought about it. First of all, I never dreamed the stuff would live on and on and on through the years.
I understood more of the evolution of the pictures in some ways than I did the three-dimensional shows that we have done.
So GE, Carousel of Progress, for us, that really was a carousel of progress for us in the shop, learning to do this new kind of animation.
There's so many things that you can't see until the final thing is done. There are so many people that have work to do that you can't see until the final work is done.
Well, that's our story. And by now, I'm sure you know our theme song. So let's salute Walt and all the folks who brought progress to us all.
All of us should know the song by now. Let's sing it together.
Oh, there's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, and tomorrow's just a dream away. Man has a dream, and that's the start. He follows his dream with mind and heart. And when it becomes a reality, it's a dream come true for you and me. So there's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow shining at the end of every day. There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.
Be careful now, Mother.
Don't worry about me, dear.
Mother's pretty ingenious, like using her food mixer for stirring paint. Well, that's my wife, Sarah. You know, I remember when...
There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow shining at the end of every day. There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, and tomorrow's just a dream away. Man has a dream, and that's the start. He follows his dream with mind and heart. And when it becomes a reality, it's a dream come true for you and me. So there's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow shining at the end of every day. There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, just a dream of.